Right. For this first exercise, really it can be done at any size, and perhaps as you gain experience you'd like to challenge yourself and do a smaller version. I would suggest a small version would be 15 millimeters square, a large version double that at 30 millimeters. So we're going to plump for 25 millimeters, which is close to an inch square for those of you working in cubits and freedom eagles, isn't it? Freedom eagles, that measurement system they use in the colonies. So this is brass sheet. I recommend using brass for your exercises rather than copper, because it's quite a crisp metal. So when you file it and so forth, you can achieve a nice sharp edge. Copper being quite a lot softer, it's easier to round out, and so achieving the kind of precision that we'd like in these exercises so that we can develop our skills, brass is far better for that exercise. As an apprentice, we used brass really early on. We used nickel silver. Of course, that's not recommended anymore, but that was lovely to work with. So brass it is. You don't want it too thin, sheet too thin. This is 1.1 millimeters thick. You don't want it too thick either, but you do want some substance to it so you can see the edge of the metal when you're filing. And I'll talk a little bit about that, or quite a lot about that, when we get to the filing of the actual square. So what I'm going to do first of all is I'm going to roughly mark out a 30 millimeter square off this corner, and then we'll proceed from there. So I've got my vernier calipers. These are quite handy for this kind of rough marking out. There's normally a locking off screw here, or some hooligan I loaned this to many years ago returned it without the screw. But I've set it to 30 millimeters. Just lightly mark it. It's just a very loose guide for me. It's oversized. And I'll cut that out. So with my saw frame, I'm putting it on my chest bone, my breastbone rather, leaning into it to tension it. Saw blade with the teeth down, facing towards me. This is a 03 saw blade. I prefer the Swiss brands, Velorb, for example. Tighten the top, and I'm tightening the bottom, and that's the pitch you want. Nice and tight. A lubricant is usual, beeswax. This is a commercial lube cut. I don't know what it's called, but it's pretty good. It's not as sticky as beeswax. And make sure your light's such that you can see what you're doing. I use my thumb just to start, and what I like to do, different people have different approaches. Some people cut down immediately. I tend to push upwards to create a little notch, and then I'll cut from there. Notice I'm angling my cut forward. What that means is that there are more teeth in connection with the metal, and it's creating a little channel, and it makes it a little easier to cut a straight line. I'm cutting ahead of myself. Really important to keep the metal such that it doesn't bounce around, so it's supported on the bench peg. And obviously I don't want to run into the bench peg. You hear the sound, it's quite steady. But if I were to come out a bit more, it would vibrate. So you want to eliminate any vibration, bring it nice and tight. You don't have to kill your hands clamping it, but just stop any vibration. Let the saw do the work. Running into the wood there. There you go. Now, another thing to say, if you've got a guillotine or shears, you could very easily cut this out. The problem there, of course, is though that the edges often get distorted, and what I really wanted to do was avoid having my little piece of brass in any way upset on the edges. But I will cover how to flatten a plate in a moment. So turning my plate around, coming in this side. Pushing upwards. There we go. And as I'm sawing, I'll take this out now. My blade is just to the right of the line, and I'm looking here. My eye is right on the edge of the blade as it skirts the scribed line. Now, don't feel you have to be dead on the line. In this case, of course, you can be on the line because I've allowed for 5 millimeters extra all the way around. But in general, you don't want to be exactly on the line if your scribe line is your finished shape. So you can start a little way off, but try to stay, you know, reasonably close. You don't want to have to spend an hour afterwards filing to the line again. So you need to push yourself to try and attain accuracy and efficiency. It occurs to me also, as you're filing along, sawing along rather, the filings gather on the metal and you can't see the line. And all it takes is a bit like when you're driving very tired. It just takes a moment of inattention or blindness to make an error. So it's important to either blow away or brush away your filings as you proceed. You've got to be able to see what you're doing. At the end, and then I bring the blade upright. Okay, so we can dispense with that. Now, the underside of the brass has a protective... So the underside of the brass has a protective plastic coating. So to make my life easier, and perhaps make what happens next more visually interesting, I'm going to peel that off. So that's just a milled finish. It's not particularly attractive, but at least it's clean and not marked. Now, as you can see, this finish is a linear finish, and it's quite bright, so any scribe lines or marking lines I make in this direction are not going to be very visible. It's also not very pleasant to work with metal shining at me like this, so I'm going to emery this. In my more classical work, I would use a Scotch stone. It provides a much flatter surface, but I'm assuming that 99.9% of you won't have Scotch stones, so emery paper it's going to be. You could use your buff stick, and let's see how this gets on. It also tells you how flat your piece of metal is. It's relatively flat. It's also getting rid of the burrs on the edges, which is a little bonus. But it's still got quite a glare, so I'm going to take a piece of the emery off. Much is overdue, anyway. And I'm just going to use a circular scrubbing motion to give the metal a nice even finish. I think this is about 1,000 grit emery. I call it emery paper. I have to say I'm not fond of the modern, or should I say contemporary habit of calling it sandpaper. Use sandpaper for woodwork. And sandpaper would just mess your metalwork up, so if you have any consideration for my delicate ears and sensibilities, you call it emery paper. Even though it's not all emery, because I know there's somebody out there already reaching for their keyboard to correct me in the comments. I'm perfectly aware of the chemical composition of the different abrasive materials stuck to paper that we use. So we'll call it emery, after the ancient Greek hard-nosed philosopher, Dick Emery. So we've got a bit of a matte finish, better see the surfaces. The next step is to establish our foundational line, what I will call the datum line. I'm going to use this term datum line an awful lot as we proceed. Like when building a house, you've got to have a level foundation. So our very first point is to find a datum line, which in this case means a straight edge. There is one edge that looks pretty straight, and I think it's this one. Yep, that's the outer edge of the plate. So that's pretty much on the money. But as a habit, I want to make sure for myself. So I'm taking a number 2 cut flat file, and I'm going to dress the surface. And I'm right to do so, because what we've got here, although it's relatively straight, is in fact a sheared cut. So it's been done on a large guillotine. So I'm going to come in. It's a relatively fine cut. So I'm just dressing the surface, going to one end, turning it around. And now I've got a nice flat looking surface. Let's make sure it is still flat. Yes, for the purposes of fine goldsmithing, I think that's straight and flat enough. Now here's our first point. I remember many years ago as an apprentice, one of the journeymen I worked with, looking at a plate that I'd prepared, and he said to me, the difference between a professional and a novice is how they file the edges. Now, not to show off, but I have been doing it over 40 years. This is what a professional will give you. It's a straight, flat surface that appears as one and is at 90 degrees to the plate surface. As a novice, it's very easy for that to wander, to get rolled over and to be irregular. So that's something you've really got to concentrate on. And I'm just going to show you now the kinds of things to be aware of. You've got to have your workpiece in your hand, up against your bench peg, nice and secure. You don't need to be using excessive strength to hold it. It just needs to resist the movement of the file. So I'm actually filing into the bench peg, not into my hands. My hands are just there to keep it in the correct orientation. Over time, you've got to learn to get your hands to work in a coordinated fashion, so that as I'm holding this plate and I bring my file down, I should know instinctively that they're at 90 degrees or at 45 degrees or whatever position I want. So I'm watching this plate and the face of it and my file, and as I'm filing, I'm watching the effect. I'm going to say a little bit more about filing as we go around. I don't want to inundate you with too much on each plane. So the next step, having established our datum line, our true straight edge, is to mark the first corner and the first opposite edge at 90 degrees using a set square. But before we do that, you need to check that your set square is in fact true. There's a very quick and easy way to do that, to test that. And I'm not going to mark on the front here. What you need is a straight edge. We've made a straight edge conveniently. And you place your set square very carefully on that straight edge.
So I'm going to scribe a line. In theory, that should be at 90 degrees to this datum line. I'm going to turn my set square around and draw a line parallel. Got to be really careful that the metal is touching. There's no filings or anything like that underneath the metal. That's why there's this little slot here to make sure no filings get in the corner and throw you out. So I'm going to scribe here. And let's have a look.
So you can see there's a little bit of distortion at the edges where the metal rolls off. But here, on the body of the metal, the lines are perfectly parallel, which assures me, that my set square is true.
Camera one, recording camera two.
So putting the stock, that's the blade of a set square, nice and tight in there. And not to waste any metal, although I have wasted metal, haven't I? I've tucked it in nice and tight.
And now I'm going to scribe a new line. I want that nice and strong,
because that's going to be our second edge. So I'm going to use a saw and cut off some of the excess, and then I'm going to leave a fair old bit just to really focus on filing, to show you some technique that might be useful. So let me get rid of this bulk here. At this juncture, at this corner, I'd like to talk just for a minute about body posture, body mechanics, because it's really, really important. If you want to try and develop any kind of technique, you don't need to be fighting your body. So the first thing to say is you need to be seated in such a way that you're grounded. Now, we hear this word all the time, but it's my feet I'm talking about, quite literally grounded. Think of yourself as a boxer, you're 1 foot forward, 1 foot behind you. My back foot is pushing forward. Obviously, it's a very subtle thing, but it allows me to keep my body weight moving forward in a comfortable way through my leg, through my back, and working in this way. Whereas if both my feet were up on here, I'd be perching like a little pigeon or sparrow, and I'd have no stability, and I wouldn't be very able to achieve any accuracy, because everything would be moving. So feet anchored on the ground. You need to be in a position such that you're over the piece. It's no good trying to do fine work if you're working here. It might seem sensible, but it's like trying to put a light bulb in. You're straining yourself. So you really want your body in the most natural position, and your arms, ideally, when sitting at your workbench, at your normal seating height, the angle from your shoulder to your elbow to your wrist should be a nice even slope. And so there's no excess strain on my arms here, which is a good thing, really. So in this position, my feet are anchored, my body is angled to allow my arm, which will be holding the file, to work in a nice, even, smooth way. Not coming in like this, or this, or that, or fighting anything. It's a nice, gentle stroke, like a locomotive, I like to say. And my elbow is just brushing against my side. Just can feel it there. And the aim is, for your file and your hand and your forearm to be as one. That's the ideal. I don't change this, I don't change the angle of this, I change the angle of this. So this is like a machine, and my body is all working as one. Okay? So with that in mind, I'm offering my metal back up to the bench peg. And I'm using the number 2 cut now, the finer cut.
And I'm just bringing the filed edge up to that scribe line. Notice I'm stopping short. I'm just checking as I get closer into the line with my fine file that everything is true and my edges don't roll over. And I think that's about it. You know, you're pretty much on the money when part of your burr being that little furry edge that comes up, part of your burr starts to incorporate some of the scribed line, and you'll see. Well, you can try to train your eyes to see that the scribed line, which is a groove with two little furry edges, is starting to be encroached upon. And I'll talk about that in a moment further. Now there's a slight burr. I'm just going to ever so gently stroke it away, and I'm going to go back and do the same on the first edge. The reason for that is we don't want any bits of burr getting in the way and interfering with the set square when we measure this angle now. So let's go and check how we're doing. So, offering that up. If I hold it up to the light.
Lost you. No, we've lost you.
Well, I'm not going to be able to film this, or rather, Bella's not going to be able to film this, but I'm holding this up to the light to see if there's any light coming through. And you'll just have to believe me that it's absolutely light. Tight.
Hang on, wait. So, go back up there. Back up.
I'm going to put it here and see.
You're going to say it again.
If Bella can get this.
You have to move your head.
Well, that proves that the edge is 90 degrees.
Yeah.
So at this point, you might be wondering, what is the aim? What's the point, really, or the value of this degree of accuracy and precision? And as I like to make very clear to my own students in my studio, when you're making artistic objects, this degree of precision is rarely absolutely necessary. There are occasions when it is. There are certain bits of fine goldsmithing work, diamond mounting work, where this level of precision is absolutely required. But what I would maintain is that the effort and the benefits that you gain from achieving these skills carry on into everything. It's not often you're going to be required to make a little square of metal that's so precise and so that feels so engineered. But if you have a heart, for example, to cut out that has to be symmetrical, you need to know that you can file both sides exactly the same, or any other shape for that matter. It's all good and well spending time making a beautiful design and making beautiful lines, but if you can't cut safely to those lines and then file and refine your form, your design is lost. So the craft aspect of what we do, that craft skill aspect, is what enables us to manifest our creative vision. And without that, there's going to be a gap. It's a bit like having that big old gap in the file that I really detest. You're losing control of the tool. And if you don't have the skills to carry out your vision, then something's lost. It's a bit like only being able to play chopsticks on the piano, but really wanting to play the Flight of the Bumblebee. You've got to do the basics. You've got to get the basics right. And it's as simple as that. So I will maintain that there's immense benefit in just doing these kind of very basic exercises. And as I hope becomes evident in the way I explain the processes and the techniques and how to carry them out, by learning to do them properly, and by properly I mean in the sort of age-old traditional way, you're able to work more effectively. There's less strain on your body. I've never had a repetitive strain injury in my body ever. And that's despite 23 years of quite severe autoimmune disease that has damaged my muscles. I've got less than 30% lung function. I've got a damaged heart. I'm still working. And that's, I believe, because I learnt a way of working that was the least damaging to my body and the most supportive. And in that way, I mean, quite frankly, it probably saved my life. So I will absolutely maintain that learning the technique in such a way that allows you to work effectively, gently, will enlarge the enjoyment you get from the work, but also enable you to keep doing it for longer. And really, at the end of the day, that's what matters. So you'll have to bear with me, because I'm going to be a stickler for this. So now we've got two sides that are perfectly straight and at 90 degrees to each other. We're going to do the third edge. This time, the length of that edge has to be set, and we've decided on 25 millimeters. So with two edges, that one and that one, I'm going to make this edge 25 mil. Now, you can use a ruler, offer it against the edge to 25 mil and scribe a little mark, and then use your set square. Or, which is what I more usually do, set my dividers on my trusty vernier scale. 25 mil. And then, as carefully as I can, offer them to the metal from the corner. Now made a little mark. So what I did there was I held the tip of the dividers literally over the corner. And that idea of splitting the difference again, the tip of that comes to a point, I place that over the edge of the metal, and now I'm going to scribe a line off that dot there to the other side, given that this is a prepared straight edge. Again, splitting the difference. The scribe going through the center of that little dart, tucking the metal right up against the stock of the set square, and there's that. And just to double check, you know what they say, measure twice, cut once. So I'm just checking. Yep, that's a smidgen over 25 mil, which is exactly what I want. Now I'm going to cut that excess off, cutting to this side of the line, and then we'll get that edge 90 degrees. You can see where we're going now. All right. Yeah.
Now, as I come to the end, I don't want to pop through, so I press it up against the bench peg and I cut into the wood. There we go. And so, as before, I'm going to file with the number two cut at 45 degrees, roughly. So I'm just coming in ever so gently, 45 degrees. Gonna touch that line. Remember, we're a little bit over in width, so I can afford to go into the line quite aggressively, relatively speaking. But I don't want to remove it entirely, because if I do, I've lost my guide. Okay.
So now using the zero cut again,
and the bevel's on this side, the light's falling on it. I'm going to come across and start chewing it out. Let the file do the work, turn it round. So flip the plate around to do the other end, and now you can see the bevel, which I'm normally seeing from this side. And that's my guide, of course. I'm just watching that bevel disappear, and I want it to disappear evenly. And just to note again, I don't roll off the edges, I stop short, so the file is still supported. Little ripples on the edge. That's because the file isn't at an optimum angle for taking the metal away. That's more like it. And notice the angle I'm coming at. So I'm picking up all of the metal, not going in little spots. And by doing it at an angle like this, there's more of the file resting on the plate than where I just do 90 degrees. So I'm going to take the burr away. You can see a little bit of burr rising there. Now, it's worth marking this at this point. So this is the face we're working on. These two we've done. So I know this is correct, and this is correct, and that corner is correct. So I want to mark these so I don't accidentally start filing on that when it's just this edge I need to be working on. So I'll take a pencil and do an old woodworker's trick and mark these faces. So that's one side done. I'm using a marker pen now, and another one done. So this is the edge we're working on. So hopefully these little marks will remind me not to go back there, because that's done and dusted. So I'm going to use my vernier gauge. Great thing about vernier gauge in this instance is these two faces are parallel. So I trust these. So I'm not just measuring, I'm also checking. So it's a little tight here, but not here. Now, it's such a tiny bit. A bit of elbow grease would probably correct that. And what I've got in terms of measurement is 25.15. if I measure it further down, it's 25.03.
I'll probably have to do a little video on how to read this. We'll do it at the end of this particular exercise. So let's do some tweaking.
Yeah, that's 25.1, and this end is 25. So I really don't want to touch down here, it's 0.1 out there. Now I'm being just silly, but it amuses me, so. Still 25.1.
I'm being literally ridiculous now. But I think that's 25. Can you? So now we've got one last edge to cut off and square up. So once again, I know that all three sides are done and I just need to measure a length, mark a 90 degree angle and cut it off. And because there's some scrap markings, I don't know what that is, but that was the excess metal. So I know that is the bit that's got to come off. My marks to preserve the sides have rubbed off a little bit. So I'm going to check that my dividers haven't changed or goblins haven't come in. Nope. So the measurement is still okay. It's just worth doing because sometimes it's easy to forget if you've picked up a measuring tool and or somebody's been in the workshop, brought you a cup of tea, lovely, and then they've fiddled with your dividers, not lovely. So let's mark an edge again.
Nobody would do that.
No, you would have to get a new person. If they did. So I'm hovering the right hand side of the dividers over that corner. My fingers are resting on the plate, everything's supported. On the left hand side, I'm bringing down and I've made a little dot. There it is.
For a little bit more on accurate marking, the use of dividers and so forth, you could check out a video on exactly that. I'll put a link below to that video. So there's my little dot at 25mm. And using my set square, tuck it in nice and tight.
offer it up. Again, split the dot with the set square. I'm pulling it in really tight and using my pin scriber. Scribe the line nice and clear.
Scriber, you can use any scriber really, but as should be obvious, the finer the scriber, the more accurate your marking art is going to be. So I like to use an actual pin in my pin vise as my scriber for this kind of work. Now all that remains is to remove this excess and file up to the line. Let's see if we can do it without buggering it up like the English rugby team at the last moment.
Good walk. So, thumb on the blade, holding it in position, and a gentle stroke upwards and down, and I've got a little groove nice and in place.
Cut off. Using the 2-0,
put that little bevel on to the line. Right, I trust that that's correct. And now, using the zero cut coarser file, take off some of the excess. Using that little bevel as my guide again.
There's a sliver of bevel left, but I want to measure now.
So just under 25.2. Let's just try that side. 25.2. So we've got 0.2 of a millimeter to dispense with. I'm really hitting the center here, bit of pressure and then easing off as I get to the end, because if I keep the same pressure as I get to the end and there's less file on the brass, all that pressure is in a smaller area, so you tend to take off more metal. So you have to adjust the pressure as you travel across the metal if you want to maintain the same rate of metal removal. Shall I say that again? You've got to maintain the pressure relative to the amount of brass you're on. So here, I can put all the pressure on, but here, if I put the same amount of pressure, I'm cutting less brass. So I'm going to cut more with the same amount of pressure. So I need to hard, hard, soft, soft, soft as I go towards the edge. It's a slight thing. It's almost, you have to do it in your mind. What I'm feeling is something between there and here as I'm moving along. Still 25.2. Just a little under that side. So closing in on 25.1. 25.1. So, nearly there. Perfect. Perfect. Right, so that's 25 mil. 25 point nothing. And that's the bar. And although this should be superfluous, just checking the square. Well, that's quite satisfying. That then is a 25 millimeter square with 90 degree corners. The edges are straight, as you can see, no sloping off. The thin edges are flat and at 90 degrees to the plate. We'll call that step one of exercise one.